Shabbat Shalom. This week, we begin reading the book of Deuteronomy, of Devarim. Unlike the other books of the Bible, this one is simply a retelling of the journey we have already taken. There is very little new information presented, just a rehashing of the past years. We are close to entering the Promised Land, but before we do, Moses recounts our stories and our laws to us. He reminds us of the paths that we took, the battles that we fought, and which of those battles we won and lost. He reminds us that we are supposed to make this journey in a much shorter time, but due to our stiff-neckedness, lack of faith, and complaining, God decreed that no one from the slave generation would enter the land of Israel. So now, 40 years later, he is reminding us of our parents' journey and cautioning us to follow God's laws, lest the land spit us out. While there's a few lapses in his memory, or maybe a conscious choice to remember some of the parts a little differently than they occurred in the earlier books, Moses doesn't sugarcoat our journey. What's interesting is that he not only reminds us of the times that were hard for us, he also takes the time to remind us of the times that we ourselves screwed up. Sure, it's easy to lament about all of the bad things that happened to us, but it's much more uncomfortable to talk about the bad things that we did ourselves. You know, the time we made a golden calf, many times we questioned God or complained and even claimed that it would be better to have been left in Egypt. Along with the retelling, though, something amazing happens. Moses and the Israelite people, to some extent, seem to take responsibility for their actions. They recognize that mistakes were made and that growth was experienced. Moses made some poor decisions and accepted the consequences. While he clearly laments the fact that he won't be allowed into the Promised Land, he accepts his fate and asks only to be allowed to gaze out onto the land. And for our part, we too seem to accept the fact that our parents made some grave mistakes, and we promise not to repeat them, although we repeat most of them in the end. Several months ago, I spoke about how memories are supposed to make us better, not bitter. So why then is Moses focusing so much time on all of the times we screwed up? Shouldn't he use this time to build our confidence and remind us how lucky we are to finally be entering this promised land? Shouldn't he be cultivating our memories so that when we enter Israel, we enter with a heart full of gratitude towards God, not painful reminders of all the times we disobeyed and paid the consequences? Why are we reliving our negative moments? Psychological research and anecdotal evidence suggests that we learn more from our mistakes than from our successes. Maybe because when things go well, we don't take as much time to be reflective. Or because when they're going well, we don't have an impetus to really change or grow. But regardless, we know that if we truly take the time to reflect and consider our failures, there is much growth to be found. Having the ability to take responsibility and grow from our actions is a sign of emotional intelligence. In fact, the whole point of the High Holy Days, which are quickly approaching, is that if we believe we have nothing to repent for, then we have no opportunity for growth and improvement. In addition to learning from our mistakes, it's also important to accept that we are not perfect and that perfection shouldn't even be the goal. There is value in recognizing that things don't need to be perfect. As I often teach, the fact that our biblical heroes are far from perfect actually make them more attainable and relatable. After all, if we were only provided with examples of perfection, we're bound to fall short. In allowing and owning our imperfections, we are confirming our humanness. In today's world, social media has skewed our notion of normal. When we scroll through the posts and pictures of our friends and acquaintances, we often see picture-perfect families at beautiful destinations or gorgeous home-cooked meals that look like they should be in a restaurant. I don't know about you, but when I see these, my own insecurities rise a little bit, as my family rarely captures a picture where we are all looking at the camera and smiling at the same time. And while my home-cooked meals taste pretty good, they don't look like they came from a restaurant. It's in those times that I have to remind myself that too often we curate our lives for social media. We only put the beautiful stories and pictures. Every trip looks picturesque and happy because we don't post the pictures from the day that it poured the whole time and we fought about who could sit closest to the plug to charge your iPad. We don't post about the vacation that was a total flop and the meal that got burned and didn't look anything like it was supposed to. A friend of mine has a name for this. She calls it the picture before the picture. What she does is she posts the picture that came right before that beautiful family picture. She has two young boys and she often posts adorable pictures of them. But along with that perfect family shot, she'll also show the picture that was taken in the moments before she got that one, where she's bribing her kids to smile, making faces, or when they even refuse to come into the frame. With her picture before the picture, she's reminding us that even though we may end up with one great shot, the road there isn't all rainbows and unicorns. So too with our memories. Allowing for the struggle to remain part of the remembered journey allows us to continue to learn and grow from those struggles. When we look back on our lives and our decisions, it's normal and sometimes even helpful to focus on the positive, but it's also important to leave space for the negative memories. The beautiful Israeli songwriter Naomi Shemer speaks of this in one of her most famous songs, Al Kol Ele. Every bee that brings the honey needs a sting to be complete. We all must learn to taste the bitter and the sweet. Al kol ele, for the sake of all these things, O Adonai, let your protection and mercy be complete. Bless the honey, bless the sting, bless the bitter and the sweet. Shabbat shalom.